Morning.
Morning.
Hey, good morning.
Good morning.
Morning, everyone. This is Victoria with Councilwoman Cindy Nguyen's office.
Morning.
Morning, Victoria.
Morning.
Morning, Victoria.
You see some familiar faces.
Indeed, it would have been a lot better if this was over coffee, right?
Absolutely.
It's not nearly as much fun.
All right.
One day soon.
Fingers crossed.
All right, everyone, it's 11:03. We are gonna go ahead and get started. Thank you to the New Orleans Business Alliance for hosting us on their Zoom platform, because our office doesn't have one. Just another reminder that this meeting is gonna be recorded and will be placed on our website after the meeting is over. Naomi, can you go to the next slide? Thank you. So this is going to be our agenda today. We'll just do a quick welcome and introductions. We'll talk about our vision for this solicitation, a little bit about the opportunity that it represents. We have some expertise from our procurement office to talk about the process. And we also have an expert from our Office of Supplier Diversity to talk about DBE requirements. And then we'll have some time at the end for Q&A. In the meantime, if any questions come up during the presentation, you can put them in the chat box and we'll make sure to get to them. All right, next slide. One more. Thank you. So our presenters today are going to be Jeff Schwartz. He's the director of the city's Office of Economic Development. I am Courtney Stuckwish-Wong. I am also in the city's Office of Economic Development. We have Louis David from the New Orleans Business Alliance, Grady Fitzpatrick from Greater New Orleans, Inc., Kai Wells from the city's purchasing office, and Monique Bourgeois from the city's Office of Supplier Diversity. So with that, we'll go to the next slide and we'll be talking a little bit about the vision for this solicitation. And we can go to the next slide and I'll turn it over to Jeff Schwartz from the city's Office of Economic Development.
Great. Thank you so much, Courtney. And it really is great to see everybody here. I'm excited to see, shouldn't be surprised, but I'm excited to see so many familiar faces here and also some new ones, which is really great. And frankly, you know, I think what we were all hoping for. As Courtney mentioned, my name is Jeff Schwartz. I am the Director of Economic Development for the City of New Orleans. I joined a little more than a year ago now. You know, as I like to joke, it's been 3.5 disasters since I joined. And so hopefully if I get any of the blame of that, I'll get at least a little bit of the credit as we hopefully navigate through this all together. This RFQ and the Six Flags project in general have been a really big priority of mine personally, but in particular, the Office of Economic Development and the Cantrell administration. I think it's probably obvious that the New Orleans East community is a priority among all communities that I know the mayor values so much. And this is a site that I think we all know has become a little something of an albatross over the last 13 or 15 years, even since Katrina. And I think one of the questions that we hope we can answer today And then going forward through this solicitation process is that we have every intention of making this time different. We have every intention of seeing this be a expedient and successful process to find a master development partner who the city and the Industrial Development Board can get into a relationship with, and then see through the successful revitalization of this really amazing property over hopefully a short period of time. I think I'll start there with the goals of the RFQ. You know, I think that at the end of the day, setting aside the history that I know we all know far too well at this point, is just how amazing of a site this really is, with frontage on two interstates, within levee protection, with utilities to it. And I think, you know, for those of us that have spent any amount of time either in the real estate world, the economic development world in the city, and particularly in New Orleans East, this is a signature property. And, you know, we have every intention of making sure that it receives that attention, and that there's a really wonderful creative proposal that gets selected for implementation at this site. A couple of highlights that we'll pull out from the RFQ that you all will see in the document that will go live on Wednesday, and we'll talk about the timeline a little later in the presentation. But we are excited as the city and the Industrial Development Board, and I should note that the city has a cooperative endeavor agreement with the IDB to lead this redevelopment process. Our goal is to bring the site back into commerce as an amenity, first and foremost, that truly benefits the community on every level and makes use of that really strategic location. One of the items that I am keenly interested in is making sure that this property becomes a catalytic economic development project that will make sure is creating jobs and is aligned with our priority industries in the city. It doesn't mean that all of the site can't be some other use, but that at bottom we want there to be an economic development component in this project, whatever ends up being proposed and done at this site. We want it to be appropriate. So we know that there are a whole number of uses that can creatively be done here, but that we want it to be done, you know, in lockstep with the community's kind of wants and needs, in addition to the larger community and economic development priorities of the city. We want it to be very integrated. We don't want this to be an ad hoc process or one that doesn't align with some of the larger strategic priorities that exist in the community. There are many, so it shouldn't be hard to identify one or a couple that this could align with. But we want to make sure that this site, really is referencing its strategic location, both in New Orleans East on the interstates, but also backing up to Bayou Sauvage and thinking about what are some of the elements that could be done here that really speak to a 21st century development. And then most broadly, we want this site to help spur continuing vibrancy in the New Orleans economy. Especially now that's an even more poignant point, given what has happened in our community and across the country with COVID and the pandemic. We know that today there are somewhere between 40 and 50,000 of our fellow New Orleanians just in Orleans Parish alone who are unemployed. That number has frequently looked lower in recent months, but that is because many of our fellow New Orleanians are seeing their unemployment benefits actually expire without some federal intervention. And so out of a workforce of about 200,000 people in Orleans Parish, that is a staggering number. And so we know that we need this site to come back in a way as a key publicly owned asset, as a way of driving the economy of the future that helps us diversify our economy and creates jobs in industries where we know there will be opportunities for growth that pay higher wages, and where there's opportunities for wealth creation, particularly for our Black and Brown entrepreneurs in the city. And so we have a lot of goals with this. We know that, in some ways we're looking for a unicorn. We're also pragmatists. And so we're very excited to work with folks who are considering putting in a response to make sure that this process can achieve as many of these, really aspirational goals as possible. So with that, next slide, please. I believe I'll turn it over, Lewis or Grady, I believe, is going to take over here. So I will turn the mic over to them to go through some of the site assets and contextual elements that make this site so great for redevelopment.
Jeff, Grady and I will switch off. I'll do a couple slides and Grady will take over. We really do think that this site has the potential to really transform the eastern side of New Orleans East. As we've said, the total available acreage is 227 acres. That's divided up, as you can see here, into the main site, which is the former Six Flags site. And then there is an adjacent 65-acre site. And we're calling them main site and parcel one. That's how they have been described in various documents that the IDB has back and forth. So just keeping with their nomenclature. And then, you know, surrounding these sites, especially on the south side of I-10, are a number of privately owned sites that are available for sale as well. So when you look at this entire, you know, kind of corridor that could be available, it's a pretty unique piece of property sitting at the corner of two interstates at the gateway to New Orleans. So we can go to the next slide. We have some information kind of on the area. So this is a slide that Grady and I talk to companies all the time about the potential project, especially in New Orleans East, because there's so much accessibility and there's so much infrastructure, especially for projects that require a lot of transportation, logistics, light manufacturing. So the site is just really at a unique location where it brings together all of the infrastructure and location advantages of being in New Orleans. You know, fronting I-10 and I-510, we have six Class A railroads that come through New Orleans, and three of them, two as well as the New Orleans Public Belt, are nearby to the site in the eastern part of the city. That's CSX and Norfolk Southern. Lakefront Airport is about 7-8 miles away from the site, which offers great accessibility for private air transportation. And then the new terminal at Louis Armstrong is about 20 miles from the site. And as a lot of people saw a few weeks ago, Amazon Air has increased service to New Orleans, showing the importance of some of the last mile distribution and for retail goods, as we've changed our economy to get a lot more things delivered to our homes as opposed to shopping. You've also got great access to, you know, our water infrastructure, you know, the Mississippi River, the lake, the Inner Harbor Navigational Canal, and the Intracoastal Waterway are all within a few miles of this site. So, we've had lots of folks talk about distribution, you know, coming from the port, then getting onto trucks, distributing across the south. So we just feel like there's a lot of opportunity and there's a lot of transportation opportunity at this site specifically. And then we did have at the bottom, just to make it very clear, the site is owned by the Industrial Development Board and the city. Jeff and Courtney specifically are managing this redevelopment process. So we're excited to have this opportunity to market, and Grady and I will be kind of spreading the word from upon high with national site selectors, local real estate development folks, regional, local, and national real estate developers and organizations. So Grady, I'll let you talk a little bit about that as well.
Sure. Thanks, Lewis. Next slide, please. So Lewis talked a lot about the infrastructure that's out there. And I think another important piece is just the population that exists kind of within these radiuses. So, you know, obviously Houston, Memphis, you know, it, especially coming from, I think, the eastern side, if you're coming into New Orleans, you're going right past the site with that great frontage. But as Lewis talked about, you know, all our conversations with site selectors, it's supply chain, distribution, That's really kind of the wave of the future. So, you know, if that's a concept that, you know, is interested to developers, I think this site plays really well into that, and just being able to kind of, it's not just about infrastructure, it's about getting those products to the people. And so, as you know, these metros continue to grow. As Lewis mentioned, I mean, Amazon Air is, you know, it was kind of a nice feather in the cap for the airport. We'll see more activity with cargo at the airport, and kind of utilizing that 610 split to get to the site pretty quickly and avoid downtown is key. Next slide, please. And just the, you know, from our kind of metro region too, if you look at the amenities being close, I mean, I think everyone on the call is pretty familiar with the site or New Orleans, but you know, you are into the quarter, into Audubon Park, you know, with, you know, less than probably, you know, 10, 15 minutes, as we joke, everything's kind of 15 minutes away in New Orleans. And this site might be kind of looked at as, you know, a little bit outside, but everything is fairly close. And then, you know, I mentioned the airport. You also have, you know, a lot of the activity, you know, in Slidell is continuing to grow. You've got Hancock County, Biloxi and Mobile are not far as well. So, you know, the ability to kind of access those two on the east and the west side without having to go through downtown New Orleans is key. I think we got one more slide. And, you know, these are kind of some of the more, you know, I think the Bayou Sauvage and Audubon nature, you know, obviously it's kind of that, as Jeff was talking about, the environmental piece, which is, you know, quality of life is becoming so important, and kind of accessing you know, the nature side of it. If you look at, you know, the folks that are leaving the metro areas in San Francisco, they're going to Salt Lake, they're going to places where you have that access. But then the retail is starting to build. And, you know, I think we'd be remiss if we didn't talk about, you know, just the industry happening in New Orleans East with obviously legacy like Folgers and Dupuy, but you've got Starlight Studios out there. Let's not forget NASA, who's not going anywhere. They're doubling down. There's going to be I don't know if it's going to be mentioned, but the space campus, I think we'll see more investment into NASA. So I think that's, you know, kind of a unique thing for New Orleans East. And then Dixie, if you haven't been out to Dixie yet, you got to go check it out. It's a great facility. So I'll just end by, you know, I've been really impressed with Jeff and Courtney and their commitment and the mayor to this project. So excited to help move it forward.
Thanks, Grady. Thank you, Lewis. We will move to the next slide, and we're going to talk a little bit about the procurement process. We have Kai Wells from the office, from the procurement office, who can go through a little bit about this process. Kai, are you there?
Yes, I am. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, everyone. As Courtney mentioned, my name is Kai Wells, and I'm the assisting purchasing administrator in the Bureau of Purchasing. And I'll just discuss a few details of the RFQ process. For one, and most importantly, the RFQ will be released on Wednesday, December 16th. The deadline for the submission of responses will be February 9th, 2021. Regarding the selection process, following the submission deadline, the submissions will be evaluated by a selection committee. The committee will first evaluate and rank the prospective submissions to the RFQ in accordance with the technical criteria, which will be described in the RFQ. The city may, at its discretion, create a shortlist of respondents who will be subject to a second phase, with the result of that second phase being a selection. Once the RFQ is released, copies of the solicitation and related information will be available on the city's purchasing portal, which can be accessed via our website, purchasing's website, at nola.gov/purchasing/brass. For prospective respondents, please be mindful that there will be a cone of silence. Once the RFQ has been released, all questions must be directed to the designated purchasing official, which will be identified in the RFQ itself. There is a prohibition on communication by respondents or anyone on their behalf with the city staff, board members, and elected officials. The only exception being that DBE related questions can be directed to the Office of Supply Diversity. So I think that's pretty much all from me. So I'll sort of segue to Monique from the Office of Supply Diversity.
If I can really quickly, Monique, sorry to jump in real quick. Kai, thank you so much for that. And I just wanted to note, you know, I think, you know, our goal in this process is, as you can see, is to make this as expedient as we can. We want to move through this. We've been, Kai and her team in procurement have been really amazing. And I think, you know, what we're trying to do here is identify a very diligent path where we, you know, we make sure we're vetting proposals as ardently as we can. And then we want to see this site, you know, get into, you know, an exclusive relationship with the development partner who's going to do a transformative project here, but not draw this out for 9 months or a year. This is something that we expect to do through quarter one and maybe early quarter two of 2021. But I just wanted to highlight that that element there, Kai, before moving on. So thank you.
Thank you.
So if we can move to the next couple of slides, we're going to have Monique Bourgeois from the Office of Supplier Diversity review DBE requirements.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Again, I am Monique Bourgeois with the Office of Supplier Diversity. I am a compliance officer here in the office. This contract will have a DBE goal of 35%. Per the RFQ, the respondent agrees if they are selected, they will use their best efforts to carry out all applicable requirements of the city's DBE program on the contract. All respondents must submit a completed DBE participation plan form with their response, which is the DBE compliance form 3. This form is found within the RFQ. Without a completed form, your submission will be deemed as non-responsive. At this period in the selection process, it is understood that a respondent may not yet have a team and or DBEs as part of their response. Under sections 1, 2, and 3, it is acceptable to write TBD. The focus of the DBE participation plan at this stage of the project, we'll focus on the respondents' responses to sections 4 and 5, the respondents' past performance record, and the narrative details as to how the respondent will achieve the DBE participation goal throughout each phase of the project. The next slide, please. Okay. Counting DBE firms must be certified with either the SLDBE program or the LAUCP program. DBEs must be certified in their respective listed scopes of work. And both of these directories are listed or linked to the OSC webpage at the NOLA.gov website under economic development. That website is www.nola.gov/economic-development/supplier-diversity-directory. Next slide, please. Continuing DBE participation, counting DBE participation, the commercially useful function in determining whether a DBE certified firm is performing a commercially useful function, factors including but not limited to the following shall be considered. The first is whether the firm has the skill and expertise to perform the work for which it is being utilized and possesses all necessary licenses. Whether the firm is in the business of performing, managing, or supervising the work for which it has been certified and is being utilized. And lastly, whether it is performing a real and actual service that is a distinct and verifiable element of the work called for in the contract. Next slide, please. DBE compliance and reporting. The Office of Supplier Diversity's compliance team is charged with monitoring and reporting DBE participation on city's contracts to ensure DBE firms get their fair share of procurement opportunities. The B2G Now compliance monitoring system is used for reporting DBE participation and compliance reports are required for each contractor and subcontractor on a monthly basis. The compliance officers conduct announced as well as unannounced site visits to monitor contract compliance in the field. Next slide. This is just an example of the landing page of the B2G Now system, and that's business to government system, in which you would be doing the reporting. Next slide, please. And lastly, for general questions regarding the DBE program, you can contact the compliance officers or anyone within our office at supplierdiversity@nola.gov or at 504-658-4209. And also we have our list of individual team members as well with their respectful information. For all contract specific questions, we ask that you please contact the purchasing agent. Thank you.
Thank you, Monique. Mm-hmm. So at this time, we will go to the next slide. That concludes the formal part of our presentation, and we will now do some Q&A. Given the number of participants that we have on the call, we are going to begin with Q&A via the chat box. So if you could write in the chat box, sorry, that was my dog. If you can write in the chat box the questions that you have and make sure that the chat reflects everyone, or if you just want that, you can just send it to me, Courtney, in a private chat, and I will read it to everyone. So we will go ahead and do that now.
Maybe just to take up a little bit of airtime here while folks are typing their questions, I just wanted to note one of the things that I'm sure will come up in the Q&A is around the solicitation itself and what the city is looking for. It's maybe the $64,000 question here. We are actually treating this as a blue sky solicitation. It's a request for qualifications for proposals or really responses from firms, from individuals who believe that they have a great idea and the wherewithal to do something at this really key site. And so, you know, we are treating this as blue sky. We're willing to hear whatever proposals come in, or I should say responses. We are not looking for in this around 2 month window that this will be open. We are not necessarily looking for specific, cash flow projections and looking at a full on development prospectus. We are looking for really good ideas and folks who can demonstrate a track record of being able to bring those to market. We obviously, as Lewis and Grady and all of us touched on, you know, we know that this site will work really well for certain uses. But that doesn't mean that we believe that those uses are the only ones that should be entertained. And so whether it's in entertainment or in trade and logistics or the film industry or something in the blue and green sectors or STEM, which is, you know, something that is all of which are priorities of the administration, we are willing to entertain responses from all of those. So I just wanted to note that, not sure I made that as clear as possible at the outset. So I just wanted to close on that. So with that, it looks like we have a couple of notes in the chat box, so we can start in with the Q&A in earnest.
Great, yep. Let's see, first question is, how many development groups have expressed an interest?
I guess I'll just start with the Q&A and then other folks on the panel can chime in. None. So this is, the simple answer is no one has expressed an interest formally. We've had any number of solicitations, you know, well over, I would say, a dozen, even since COVID has started, where there have been folks who have made formal or semi-formal inquiries to the city and to our economic development partners being very interested in the site for one use or another. But this is a pre-solicitation meeting. And so the actual RFQ will go live on Wednesday, the 16th, this upcoming Wednesday. And so it remains to be seen, you know, which of those will actually submit, if any. We haven't done, you know, any follow-up calls on those proposals. You know, the formal expressions of interest will come through this actual solicitation process. But the demand, we believe, is out there, which is one of the reasons why the solicitation is going live now.
Thank you. We have a question about, are we encouraging joint venture participation?
That's a great question. So yes, I think that, you know, part of what the city is ultimately assessing here is a team, you know, the ability of a team to be a master developer, to be a partner with the city and the Industrial Development Board and the communities in the East and at large. And so if there is a team, a joint venture that brings together two or three different firms, you know, capabilities and track record of success, we would absolutely entertain that through this process. We also, you know, depending on how this plays out, there might actually be the opportunity to marry some different proposals that might, or excuse me, responses that come in through the first round of the solicitation. So the short answer is yes, we are absolutely willing to entertain responses from joint ventures. Thank you for that, Eugene.
Great, thank you. The next question comes from the CEO of a school organization, Michael McKenzie, who sees impacts on youth yes. in the city every day. And the question is, can more than one entity win the proposal?
Absolutely. Thank you, Michael, so much. Yes. And thank you for, you know, your work in lifting up many of the justice, social and environmental and racial and otherwise in New Orleans East and throughout the city. The short answer, as I was just mentioning, is absolutely. You know, the mayor on down in the administration, we love, you know, STEM education. We love, you know, thinking about how some of our many challenges in the city can actually be opportunities for us to further diversify our economy and create opportunities for our youngest New Orleanians. And so if there is an innovative proposal that looks at, has an education component or has, you know, an environmental component, we absolutely would love to see those types of uses incorporated into a, you know, the thoughts that a potential respondent would formally put forward as a part of this process.
And I'll also just add that it's a large site and we believe it can accommodate multiple uses.
Indeed. Great point.
Great. Eugene Ben asks, what are the percentile numbers that you are encouraging? Not sure
what exactly that is in reference to, that if that's around percentile around the joint ventures. You know, I think we're willing to entertain, you know, any sort of you know, breakdown amongst a potential respondent. You know, if it's you know, there will obviously be the DBE requirements emerging from you know, whatever agreement is struck out of this solicitation. But we, you know, apart from that, you know, I think we're very open to understanding how a potential respondent would consider how they put their team together, an integral part of putting their best foot forward in any response. So it could be, you know, 90% major firm and 10%, you know, small entrepreneur. It could be 90% small entrepreneur and 10% firm that's, you know, bringing a balance sheet. You know, we're open to exploring and hearing from any of those types of responses. If Great. That answers your question. And if not, please do add more clarity in the chat. Thank you.
Mr. McCauley asks, what comparable revitalizations have we studied nationally or internationally that we've learned from?
That's a really good question. I think at bottom, the most important thing that we've learned, and we've looked at any number of revitalization projects, campuses, in fact, across the country. There are plenty of them. Not all of them have all of the different elements, both opportunities and challenges that the Six Flags and Jazzland site afford. But you know, there are so many examples of airport redevelopments. I would cite some of the work around Mueller Airport in Austin. There's the Pearl District in San Antonio, which is a more urban type of revitalization. But I think at bottom, what we think is most important is who we're creating a partnership with. I think that what we've learned is that any successful redevelopment is all about the public-private partnership. Frankly, it's a hackneyed and cliched term at this point, but it's one that is, you know, when done well, it's absolutely integral to achieving all of the goals that we've set forth as we discussed today. And so I think, you know, at bottom, what we are looking for most is an entity or a, you know, group of entities that can come together to create a really great revitalization and have a track record of doing so, you know, meeting those economic and community development goals, meeting those equity goals and the like. I would also point to some of the examples of in the Northeast with some of the larger revitalization sites. I mean, I think we've all seen the Brooklyn Navy Yards or the Philadelphia Navy Yards, you know, Brooklyn Army Terminal. Those are, you know, massive redevelopment sites. And so the only other element that I would highlight that I think we've really taken to heart, and as Courtney just noted, is that, you know, we are completely fine and in fact expect that a lot of folks will have to think about this in their responses in a multi-phased approach. You know, this is a very large site that has a number, again, of opportunities and challenges. We know we are very clear-eyed about what the market is and is not in New Orleans. We know we're at the bottom of the Mississippi, which is great for a lot of things, but we don't have the same intrinsic market demand that like a state of Texas has, for example, just because we don't have that many people here. But we also know that this is a strategically critical location. And so we do expect that this will have to be a multi-phase development in order to be successfully done. When you look at something like the Brooklyn Army Terminal in New York, that even took New York Economic Development Corporation 35 or 40 years to fully build out that site. I don't think it's going to take us that long for this site, at least I hope not. But we're very, you know, clear-eyed about what success will entail and the steps that we'll take to get there. So great question.
Great. Another question by Eugene Ben. Have any environmental impact studies been done?
Great question. The short answer is yes. Environmental assessment has been done. No wrecks were identified. No recognized environmental conditions were identified in the phase one. We obviously know that there are some, you know, smaller scale lingering issues related to some of the post-Katrina impacts on the site, but there were no significant environmental impacts found in the initial assessment. Obviously, with any due diligence, we'd expect, you know, a phase two and you know, continuing environmental reviews to be done. But, you know, all signs point to this being, you know, very positive and a site that's more or less development ready. That assessment will be shared as a part of the solicitation going out. There was both an appraisal done in 2016 by the IDB. Obviously, it needs to be updated, but it still has great information in it. And an environmental assessment was done. And so that will also be shared as a part of the solicitation going out.
Yes, and you can also find them at NOLA.gov/Jazzland. Yes. They are linked there right now, and they're also on the IDB website.
Perfect.
Great. Don Hebert asks about the study that NOLA BA did. It was a strategic assessment stating what entities and would work at the site. Are the results of this study being taken into account when accepting RFPs, and is the property for sale? If not, why?
That's a fantastic question, Dawn. Thank you for bringing that up. That document will also be made available publicly as a part of the solicitation and is available now, as Courtney was saying, at that same location, NOLA.gov/Jazzland. that is absolutely helping us inform, that study is absolutely helping us inform how we're thinking about this solicitation. I think it really did some great visioning work around both engaging the New Orleans East community, but also taking a data-driven view of what the opportunities are at the site. It was completed last year, so obviously it was a pre-COVID context, but we think that a lot of the data and analysis that went into reuse assessment, as we called it, it wasn't a specific redevelopment plan per se, but a lot of the data and analysis really did inform how we're thinking about this RFQ, and then also is absolutely shaping how we're thinking about what some of the specific opportunities might be and how we might evaluate those. The property, your question about whether it's for sale, the short answer is no, at least not right now. You know, I think that our goal is to likely look at a long-term ground lease for the property, both from a policy perspective with both the city and the IDB. You know, I think we're ideally looking for a ground lease, but if the right situation came forward where it made more sense from a financial and public benefit perspective, and also from making a transformative project happen here, I think we would be willing to at least entertain that. So the short answer is, I think anything is on the table, but we're I think leaning towards looking to a long-term ground lease, which by and large achieves the same effect as what actually doing a sale would achieve in terms of redevelopment. So thank you for those. Those are both great questions.
Great. So similar question, will previous market studies be shared as part of the RFQ? Mm-hmm. So I think we did share that the 2016 appraisal as well as 2016 environmental assessment are on our website, nola.gov/jazzland, as well as the 2019 strategic assessment that NOLA BA did. I also want to see if Lewis from NOLA BA can share a little bit about some of the tools on their website that have information about demographics and market qualities.
Yeah, Lewis? Definitely, Courtney. We can help, and we will put some stuff up on the NOLA.gov Jazzland site. Demographics, what kind of demographics you have in the immediate area, in the metro area, but also the region. That was one of the big things that when we landed the British Airways flight to London a few years ago, is that what was really convincing and interesting to British Airways was, we have 3 million people within a 2-hour radius. And even more when you go to a 4-hour radius and you get to hit, Mobile, Montgomery, Shreveport, Lafayette, Baton Rouge. So yeah, we can definitely help with all the business tools that are live on the NOLABA.org website.
Great, thank you. Can the site have two separate developers?
Another good question. Short answer is yes. The longer answer is that we're hoping that we get a master developer or a group that represents an ability or the capacity to enter into one agreement with the city. How that then breaks out into, as a result of this solicitation, how that then breaks out into, how the site and either the two major parcels, obviously, that are currently a part of the site right now, or if it's, if the site is further, partitioned to achieve whatever the proposed, redevelopment eventually will be. I think we're willing to entertain all of that, but, I think for now, what we're looking for in the solicitation is for one response for both sites for all 227 acres. That being said, if there is a compelling reuse for one of the sites, and you or an interested party are interested in only submitting for that, we will absolutely consider it, and it might be something that we will be able to consider in a number of ways as things come together in quarter one of next year.
Great. What kind of economic incentive package will be offered?
This is great. We are covering all the highlights here. Thank you. Yes, I think, again, short answer is that the city is deeply committed to making sure that this site is redeveloped, with a very direct timeline. We do not want this project to fall short. And so in any way that the city and its partners can be supportive of the project, we are willing to at least have that discussion. So I would say that, almost anything within our, typical or even, infrequent toolkit for incentivizing and supporting these types of high impact economic and community development projects, we're absolutely putting those on the table and are willing to, hear what any respondent has to say in terms of what they might need in terms of realizing a transformative development here. I will say that because this is an RFQ, it's not expected that a respondent will have done a full, cash flow development pro forma, sources and uses and the like in these first 60 days. This is not an RFP. This is not a solicitation for a specific proposal. And so it, I think that is one of the reasons why we're just leaving it as anything is on the table, and we're willing to get into that discussion and partnership with a successful respondent over what it will require going forward in order to bring a development to fruition.
Great, thank you. Ms. Greeley has a couple of questions. How many more RFPs will we have to go through? That's a good question. And are there any past developers in the last 15 years that the city would consider?
Great question. For all these are so on point. So ideally, I feel your pain, and I've only worked here for about 16 months. I know that, so many residents and community members in the East, I know my colleagues who have been at this a lot longer, there's a lot of water under the bridge. And so we want this to be the last time we have to do a solicitation for this site, at least for the next 50 or 99 years, if you go by a long-term ground lease. And so I think that, our goal is that this is, as Kai mentioned, a one and potentially two step RFQ process that would conclude by the end of March of 2021. So it should just be one and maybe two solicitations remaining for a prospective development partner. So thank you for that question. And then potential delays, I think at this point during a COVID pandemic, you'd like to say we've seen it all. And so, I don't want to hedge too much, but, the city is very diligently moving forward with this process. We are going to do everything that we can, within our powers to ensure that it does not get delayed any further. Once a development partner, joint venture is selected at the end of this solicitation process, we do expect that we will engage in a agreement, likely a cooperative endeavor agreement, that will give site control and exclusivity for a certain amount of time for a developer to actually put the full project together, again, in partnership with the city and many other partners. I expect that, to take at least several months beyond when the RFQ solicitation concludes. But it is our goal to do that as expeditiously as possible. And so in my mind, I truly hope and expect that would be done in the second quarter, by the end of the second quarter of 2021. So that, that's my expected timeline, and we're going to do everything we can to stick to that with no more delays. And then in terms of past developers, we know that many of them have brought their best selves to this process, their best proposals. And in the past, it hasn't necessarily resulted in a successful agreement between either the city or the IDB. And so we fully welcome anyone who has, you know, put a lot of good thinking. We know that many of you on the call here today even have been in that boat. We expect this to be kind of the, you know, the light at the end of the tunnel for all of you as well, to at least have some clarity on what is going to happen with this site. And so we would welcome any proposals from any shop that has submitted at any point over these last 15 years. So that should not hopefully dissuade them. Hopefully the whatever time this is, third time or 10th time is the charm, at least in terms of having a process here conclude instead of it being open-ended.
Great. And this is the last question that I see from Ms. Pope. Has the Sewerage and Water Board ever addressed the flooding issue, especially on Oak Island? Especially that Oak Island has dealt with for the last few years. It originally appeared to be caused by overgrown vegetation, and it was noted in the 2016 appraisal.
In the appraisal, yeah. Thank you, Ms. Pope. Yes, so we haven't actually addressed the underlying issue there, but you know, that is, again, the site is behind levee protection, and so those are simply localized drainage issues. We're aware of, it's likely just a maintenance issue with Sewerage and Water Board, as you noted, and the appraisal as well. That has not been fully addressed yet, but we expect that will be as a part of the redevelopment process. We know that there are some infrastructure needs that the City and Sewerage and Water Board, you know, will need to take care of. And so we can, you know, creatively address how that and any other outstanding issues out there, you know, that might exist. We'll address those together. But those do exist. So we're aware of some localized flooding during some, you know, 10-year and 100-year rain events that we seem to have more frequently. Those are, you know, creating some small standing water issues, but those will be addressed. I do see one. Are there any others? Oh yeah, Courtney, that was you. I just got an update on chats. Yeah. Any other questions? I've talked too much. If there are any responses for any of my colleagues here, please do chime in.
Okay, if there are no other questions, Naomi, can we go to the last slide? Thank you. Thank you for joining us today. As we mentioned, the RFQ will be released on this Wednesday, December 16th. You can find information and related information about the solicitation on our purchasing portal, which is nola.gov/purchasing/brass. So we encourage you to check it out. Just another reminder of the cone of silence that once that solicitation goes out, no one from the Office of Economic Development or other elected officials can answer questions. However, you can direct any questions you have to the procurement office. So thanks again for joining us today. A recording of this will be on our website, nola.gov/jazzland. Thanks for joining, and have a great rest of your day and week.
Thanks all. Happy holidays.
Thank you. Same to you. Thanks everyone.
Bye everyone.
Bye-bye.